They say chickeny China, the Chinese chicken.
Yeah,
that was my favorite part. Yeah. I love that shit.
Let's bam.
I thought you were dead.
Sun out of your eyes and be yourselves.
Heard you were dead.
She's dead, wrapped in plastic.
That man's dead back then.
It was worse than dead. He must be dead. Is this a dead man, Duck?
Hold on! Oh, Jesus Christ!
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the Roast Mortem Podcast. I am Tom.
I am Travis.
I'm Cody.
Oh. And I'm Mike. Woo.
Welcome to this episode.
Feeling good tonight.
Yeah, dogs.
Yeah. It's in the air.
It is so hot
I know.
Right now, but I'm feeling good.
But we have all these frosty burgers.
Yeah, but I'm dampman. I'm the damp man. Skibbity bidi bidi beep.
I'm the damp
nay,
man.
Nay, 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 nay.
All right.
All right, how was everyone's week? Did someone do something cool? Did you look at something cool? Did you touch something cool?
You know what I did that's very cool?
What'd you do?
Actually has to do with what's going on here. I designed a Roast Mortem shirt.
Oh,
the ooh. Fuck?
So we're going to set up a merch store soon. We're going to have some cool shit.
Premium merch.
And they'll be coming up, pretty soon.
Well, yeah, we're going to come out with some Prince Albert piercings with our faces on them.
Oh, no.
Only for Prince Albert's.
Yeah. Only Prince Albert. Hell yeah.
Yeah, only Mike's face.
Hell yeah. Ladies. All right, anyone else? What's going on with weeks?
I feel like I always come to the table with a city from the city that doesn't city.
Yeah, that was a great city. Sentence.
Yeah.
That was capital shit.
No, but I stepped off the train from Penn Station. I surfaced from the subterranean shithole. Mm-hmm. And I saw this woman. She was wearing these bright white slippers. Or not slippers. They were flip-flops.
Oh, okay.
And she was cleaning her feet with milky coffee.
Nice. Oh,
just
yeah.
Right in the middle of the street. Just like, I don't know, you could have bought a bottle of water or something. Like, you're gonna put that foot back in that white
milky coffee. Yeah.
Milky coffee.
That's the first time I've heard anyone washing anything with coffee. Yeah. Little milky coffee.
Milky.
I wanna wonder what substance is gross enough where you say yes to coffee over it.
Probably hot cum.
Yeah. Yes. That. Okay. Breaks it right up.
Yeah. So you guys then nothing?
Yeah. Fuck it, I'm
fuck
boring.
It, let's roll.
Yeah, let's do it.
Shit.
Tom, right. Who's on the mortician slab block thing?
Tonight, we have a very fun episode about one Hank Williams, the hillbilly Shakespeare, the white trash royalty, the new bounds of what we knew as country back in the 1940s and 50s, and we're gonna have a good time.
I already fucking hate him, Tom, because you've been playing him half of the fucking week while I'm trying to fucking program back here.
and all
I'm hearing is, my bucket calls another man daddy. Like, that's what I've been exposed to the last week. I'm trying to get my fucking video game guy to counterattack, and Tom's just doing this.
I'm here to destroy, man.
Spider-Man! Yeah.
So those of you who don't know who Hank Williams is, he's the voice of the sad Southern and soused. He's the biggest country star to ever walk the face of the earth, changing the landscape of country for the better or worse. A man who cried his heart out to millions and never truly got anything off his chest. Everyone has heard Hank songs, even if you don't know it.
Yeah.
Yep.
I saw that kid that was singing. I didn't know he was singing Hank Williams. He was singing Hank Williams in the grocery store.
Yeah.
Full Baby Bell. He's going, daddy do, daddy dee, daddy dee, ba ba ba
you just sounded like some kind of slide whistle things. Not the slide whistles, like the tubes that you go back and forth with and they make it.
Yeah, that's
you know, that
what
sound?
I mean, dude.
Like,
oh, yeah,
you were
things.
Like Ella Fitzgerald in one of those. Yeah, so before I get into Hank himself, I'm going to get into his family backstory.
All right.
I'm going back to his granddaddy.
Grandpappy. Mm.
That's where we're starting. Hank's granddaddy, Irwin Polk Williams.
Oh, fine.
Irwin.
He was a Southern...
Not Polk, Travis?
No.
You're not going to laugh at the pokey
part.
Nah,
he's an Irwin, dog.
All right.
Irwin.
Irwin. Very Jewish name. By
sorry,
the way.
Tom.
Don't apologize. Never.
Don't do it.
You're not supposed to. It's actually rude doing that here. But he was a Southern farmer who served in the Confederate Army during the Civil War, and he was captured by the Union in the Battle of Richmond.
What the fuck is that?
Now, the only reason I'm telling you this is because of the treachery that's afoot. Immediately, with his knowledge of the Confederate movements, he spilled the beans.
Oh, yeah. Oh.
And he had enough information where he got Abe Lincoln's attention.
Oh, Grabe Lincoln?
Wow. Yeah. And Grabe Lincoln, God damn it. Yeah, Grabraham Lincoln personally inducted Irwin Polk Williams into the Union.
Oh, shit.
He was that kind of traitor.
Come up,
like, I'll tell you whatever the fuck you want.
Snitch.
I got you. And Abraham Lincoln, they got... Not to say that the Union was going to win, lose that war at any point because there was so much more firepower.
There were times.
There were times. There were rough battles and shit. But we don't really know the specifics, but we definitely had the upper hand because of this gentleman.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, really?
Yes. Really? He was the guy that was like...
Snitched on the South.
Yo, guess what? The Union. Oh, dude. How you do, Union? How you do?
Here's where they keep their barbecue smokers.
Yeah. I can't eat without them. Yeah, it's impossible.
They've been smoking that pig for 45 since they declared Confederacy.
8 fortnights.
And if you destroy that pig, you destroy the Confederacy.
Cut off the head, and the body will die.
Yeah,
amen.
Cut off the toes that feed you.
Well, after the war, his traitorship was kept a secret, and he was able to return home. We only know about this from papers that were released in the mid-40s and stuff.
Oh, shit.
I guess.
Declassified.
But Illuminati. He gave up farming. He originally was a farmer, and he gave up farming and became a lumberjack.
Is that a step up? Is that an upgrade from little plants to big plants?
No, I mean, it's really just where the works be.
It's just different.
Yeah. Both very admirable traits.
So he's jacking some lumber.
I would say maybe it's a downgrade, because I saw Fern Gully, and you shouldn't knock down the trees. Says the fairies.
Right. In the world that Ferngully, I am fucked.
Ferngully is a documentary. If that's what I'm trying to get at.
Yes. It's a rotoscope documentary.
Yep, exactly.
Thank you.
Oh, I've misread that entirely.
Then in this case, it's a downgrade. But So Irwin married Martha Ann Autry. And they had two sons. One of them was Hank's father, Alonzo Hubble Williams.
Ooh. All right. I already smell like this episode has, like, the funny name disease already.
It sure does.
Okay.
Wait, did they name the Hubble space station after him?
No, they
definitely
never do.
He's that Hubble?
He's the Hubble.
My God.
That's not true at all. Don't.
No. Well, they actually called him the Hub.
They actually called him Lon.
Oh, Lon.
That's a bad, nick.
Yeah, it's, well, I mean, I don't know, Lon Chaney, like.
Yeah.
It's not a good name. No. You're right.
Yeah. You don't get my boner going nowadays. The rare nickname that comes from the second syllable.
Yes.
Did you know it's actually Irving Rames?
Really?
Yes.
Really?
Like, that's a cool nickname. You know what I mean? Like,
Irving was my great grandfather's name.
Yeah. So Ving Rames is actually Irving Rames because he did that slick, like, second syllable nickname.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Only time it doesn't work. Andrew.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, Drew's.
Because then you just Drew Carey.
You just Drew.
Do you guys ever wonder why people get called Dick when their name's Richard?
Yeah.
That's my dad's name.
Yeah. He's got a dick in his
name. Yeah, my dad's name is Dick Lee. You can go look up his social security number on my Twitter. But he loves it. He loves being called Dick because, like, you know, he'll say his name. Like, this is actually true. The last birthday he celebrated, his girlfriend called over the waiter and was like, hey, you know, I'm going to surprise him. He hates that shit, but everyone hates that shit.
Yeah.
But, like, he was like, his name is Dick. And the waitress, like, went and, like, talked to the manager, like, caused this whole big thing, like, they're going to sing, happy birthday, Dick.
Of course you can say that.
What's up, Dick? It's your birthday.
Yeah. I got you this floppy-ass sausage.
Let's move along. So now we're going to move along to Lon.
Lamy.
Lon's mother, Martha, killed herself when he was 6.
Oh.
So that's, you know, tragedy. There's a lot of tragedy in this, but here we are.
Okay.
And Irwin died when Lon was 17, so he was on his own. So what does any young man do? He becomes a lumberjack.
Got it.
In the South. That's just what it do.
Insert Monty Python.
Yeah, so he's lumberjacking off all day, and his work brought him to Georgiana, Alabama. This is where he met his future wife, Jessie Lilybell Skipper, or Lily.
Lily.
Now, Lily is one of my favorite characters in this story because of how horrible she is.
You didn't say her name right. It's Lily.
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 Right,
a lot, Lily.
Should we do a little? Yeah, a lot. Yeah, a lot, Lily. We do a little bit of a southern drawl.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't want to offend, but also, fuck your accent.
It just seems like you got nothing better to do all day than stand in the line. Somehow before me,
You ever meet a chick with a southern accent? It's very sexual.
Yeah, yeah. Super sexual.
Right off the bat.
Woo!
There's that thing where I do feel bad for some people who have that accent and they are immediately dismissed when they come here as being stupid.
Yeah.
Because they're just people. They just have an accent.
Yeah. I do that. I'm guilty of that.
I think that's a very New York thing.
I know I should stop.
Yeah, it is a New York thing. But also, there's people from Long Island and you hear their accent, you're fucking retard.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's because we're around them.
Yeah.
How you doing?
Hey,
my name's Charlie. What's up?
Hey, whoa.
How you doing?
Oh, look fucking idiot.
What's up? What's going on, boys? What's going on, boys? What's everyone doing today?
So, accents always carry a little bit of judgment.
Yeah, so we're going to have fun with that anyway, because fuck it.
Fuck.
So, Lily was from Butler County, which was in Georgiana.
Gerard.
Considered the right side of the tracks, as opposed to Juan, who was the earliest form of white trash that we have on record.
Oh, proto-trash.
Nice.
Yeah. Oh, I want to read something here real quick.
Okay.
This is a reference to the book I read. It's called Hank. It's by a gentleman named Mark Riboski, and he's a great author. It's a sick book. Get into it. That's where I got all the information from this.
Premium Rush.
But he describes Lon and Lily as the following. Neither was a prize, to be sure. He was shorter and already going bald, and she was a plain-looking hatchet-faced woman. Around 200 pounds and getting bigger.
The hatchet face?
Yeah, I love that insult.
It's a great insult.
Yeah.
It, I don't know why it hurts, though. It's like, your face is hatchet-like. It's like, thank you.
Yeah, it's sharp. It could carve a trophy.
Yeah, I could kill you with my face. You understand this, right?
Well, I like how hatchet is like ratchet. Like, hatchet is gross, but chiseled is good.
Oh, hey, yeah.
The same fucking thing.
Antonyms. But what was the other fucker's name? I forgot to make fun of the other one. We'll do it later.
All right. We're moving along here. So Lily plays a huge role in Hank's life.
Okay.
And Lon does not at all. And there's a little bit of humor behind this, I will say. So Lon was called to serve his country during World War I. Now contextualize that. Think about how close the Civil War was to World War I. It's not that far off. It's like 50 years.
Yeah. Yeah.
So his father had served in Civil War, had him later in life, and then I don't know.
Did he serve in the Civil War and World War One?
No. His father served in Civil War,
so
and Juan is serving in World War One.
Right.
While stationed in France, he sustained a non-combat related head injury and was discharged in 1919.
How did he ding his head, Tom?
No one really knows, but
did he self ding his head?
Basically, what I gathered is that he was in the kitchen when this shit went down.
Oh,
he probably was never a soldier of any kind.
Right.
He was probably doing some other service, which is very important, but also the sustaining a head injury is a little questionable.
Right.
Also,
Lon
drank like a motherfucker.
Oh, so he just fell over.
Hammered, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, he probably just got hammered.
I'm going to do a fromage. And hit
Well, I mean, yeah, I guess they were in France.
They were in France.
You're not always eating omelets in France.
No, they're eating fucking garbage in a can.
We already talked about frog's legs.
Yeah, true. That shit's tight.
Yeah.
All right, so upon returning home, he got his old job back as a lumberjack, of course, which was kind of like a traveling job, bouncing around. And they found themselves in Mount Olive, Alabama.
Shit.
And this is where they start their family.
In Alabama.
Mount Greece.
Mount Olive, Alabama. Yeah, right?
Yeah.
Back to the,
Mount Olive Garden. Mount Olive Garden, Georgia.
That's all of all the of garden.
It. Wait, is it Georgia?
Mount Olive Garden.
That's where
breadsticks. That is extra
Bama.
Spice boy.
Do you know the next natural progression of mankind? We used to holster pistols, and before that we would sheathe our swords. And now we're going to insert our breadsticks.
Where? In our gills.
You had to question where?
Where is your breadstick holster?
I like that.
Do you?
Cody, you ruining my bit?
Where do
you have to question where?
Where do you holster?
In the breadstick loving tube. Where the breadsticks are endless.
The breadstick port, you mortal. Where else do the breadsticks go on your species?
Something regal about it. So the family. The first child was born in July 1920.
Congrats.
Ernest Hubble Williams. Died 2 days later.
Bad.
That's the South. That's what happens. Yeah.
We did a natural birth in the moonshine. Because we ran in the new wave of medicine. Natural birth and water is good, so we figured moonshine will be better.
Well, baby dissolved instantly.
Yeah, we're taking an electrical extension cord, tie around the child's feet. Tie the other end around a cattle's ass and pull that shit going real quick.
That really ups the SAT scores.
Good old country birth.
Yep. August 1922, 2 years later, Lily had Irene. Irene is Hank's sister.
Uh-huh.
Hank was the last of them.
Got it.
Who was born Hiram Williams.
Hiram.
H-I-R-A-M.
Hi, Ram.
Williams.
Wait, so he's Hank? He wasn't Hank?
He was never Hank.
All right.
He was never legally Hank.
I always assumed that was Henry.
Me too.
It's my grandpappy's name.
It's a good name. Yeah. Strong name.
Henry.
Wait, is Hank a nickname?
For Henry.
For Henry.
Oh, really? Not for Hiram or whatever it is?
Hiram.
No, Hiram is, it's something,
Sounds Arabic.
Sounds French. It's out of the Old Testament. King Hiram was...
Yeah. Right, Hiram. Yeah.
So that's what he was named after, because they're all Christian-loving folk, God types, having a good time. You know,
doing the God.
Going to church every Sunday. Don't you dare talk to me like that.
Doing the God.
Lon and Lily didn't actually get around to doing the paperwork for Hiram's and Irene's birth certificates until like 11 years later.
Why not?
And when they put his name on the birth certificate, they spelt it wrong.
Whoops.
God damn.
H-I-R-I-A-M. So Hiriam.
Hiriam.
Yeah, which isn't a name.
That's like Miriam.
Yeah. So that's
Okay.
Look, it's Miriam.
M as in Mancy.
Yes. Oh.
M as in Hiriam.
Wait, did we... Wait, 12 years later. Wait, did we fill out the paperwork for this one?
Back then, they didn't really care.
Yeah, no, they didn't care.
Honestly, they didn't even care where we were born. I didn't even get my birth certificate till like... And social security number till 2 years after I was born.
Yeah. Well, there was the option back then. Now
it's just like, you in the hospital, dog.
Well, now, before... When you're in the last term of labor, they set up a Facebook page. Mandated Facebook page.
I've seen that.
Yeah.
Really?
If you don't have a Facebook page, you're not coming out.
They flush you down.
Yeah. They throw up the Zucker cam.
No way.
Which is actually, the handle of it's based on an Olive Garden breadstick.
No way.
Full circle here.
Oh, wow.
Oh, the Zuck cam.
Yeah, the Zuck cam. It's got his face, but like, you know, it's two little eyeballs that are the camera lenses. Very
stereoscopic imaging.
It's the future.
I can't wait.
Yeah, man.
It's just him doing that laugh.
Well, we're gonna have to shove those up our asses soon.
Yeah,
gotta make sure this poo is legal.
We did set up a. I had to set up a Roastmortem Facebook page. I didn't put any information on it.
Yeah, they know all about it.
Yeah, they already do.
So. Yeah, whatever. All right, so back to Hank. Hank, growing up, was a scrawny little child. This had to do with a birth defect that he had. He had spinal bifida. Yes, spinal bifida occulta, which is the one that's harder to spot.
Because it's occult.
So if you don't know what this is, it means the vertebrae is not like entirely fused together properly. So you have like nerve endings that are just kind of dangling in your spine.
Your spine make it fucked up.
Yeah.
My cousin has the bad version of that.
And like, you don't walk.
Well, she don't walk. She doesn't walk. She don't walk.
She don't walk no more.
She don't walk no more.
Well, no jokes there.
Yeah. Moving on.
Great segue. Yeah.
So Lon didn't end up doing much for Hank, but the one thing he did do is he was the first one to notice, like, Hank's fucked up back. But Lily, like, kind of wore the pants in the family and hated Lon, like, with a passion by the time Hank was out. I don't know. Why are you still fucking at that point is what I'm thinking. Mm. But she hated Lon with a passion, so Lon pointed it out, and she was just like, "You stupid, Lon. Go lay down." So nothing was ever addressed. Lily did bring Hank to a doctor like 10 years later, but the doctor didn't even catch the problem because when you have the occult aversion of spina bifida, I gotta keep doing that.
Spina bifida?
Spina
bifida.
Spouse.
Spinacopita.
Yeah, exactly. Spinacopita. When you have the occult aversion of spinacopita, you need an X-ray to actually see it.
Yeah, occult means obscured.
Yes.
Naturally, anything called occulta is going to be tricky to find.
Wait, that's like witches.
That's
witches.
Shadowy.
Yeah.
Well,
that boy got the devil in him.
He got the devil in him.
Yeah,
in
my back.
It happened to be
right
in his lower back with a tramp stamp, you would be. Anyway, let's take a break.
Isn't there something called the devil's footprint?
Yeah, yes.
I have a devil's
footprint.
Oh, you have
a devil's footprint, Travis?
Yeah, I didn't know about the devil's footprint until I went away to England, and that's where the myth comes from.
Oh.
It's basically two fat, hairy patches of hair on your back.
Yeah, it's
right on my lower back. I don't have any hair. Well, I have a little bit of hair, but the thick patches on my back. Apparently, the myth is that the devil's sitting on your back, whispering in your ear.
Telling you to drink more.
Suck it up. Take a little
drink. He's just licking my ear.
You should do your
heart all the time.
He's just singing "Lick It Up" by Kiss.
Lick it up.
Robin!
He's actually giving you good advice because he's so bored. Yeah. Like, you should do your 2009 taxes.
You've had so many bad decisions in your life that I'm going to steer you in the opposite direction.
So if anyone's interested in seeing my back patch, my hairy back patches, let us know in the comments and we'll take a picture.
Hey, we're live streaming right now.
Yeah,
all
right, sure.
We'll show it to you.
We're going to take a quick break from recording the podcast.
Travis.
All right, Hank in it.
All right, we're back to Hank. So let's talk about Lon disappearing from Hank's life.
Oh.
So I mentioned that he drank. So take some guesses as to what happened to him.
He drank.
Himself to death?
Nope.
Beat down.
1930. Lon is suffering from facial paralysis, unable to make him speak.
He's That's like, a problem if you're a singer.
Oh, it's bad. Well, no, this is Lon, not Hank. This is Hank's father.
Hank's father's like, "Dirty Hank."
So as
Hank.
Hank could have probably sang without much of his lips.
Yeah.
So, as I said before, Lily hated her husband, Lon, with a passion. So, Lily would tell the neighbors that he was suffering from shell shock from the war.
Mm-hmm. Hmm.
And Lily didn't want Lon around anymore and sent him to via train to a VA hospital in Pensacola, Florida.
Oh.
For 10 years.
Oh.
Just do this for a decade.
Yes.
Guess what? He got shell shock because he fell in the bathroom behind the trenches.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So Lon actually kind of seemed to like it. Supposedly, he would like fake his ailments so they wouldn't kick him out. His white trash stuff.
Yep.
And of course, this is on government dime. And in the 10 years he spent there, Lily only took the kids there once.
Oh,
okay.
Nice.
Once That's in a nice. Decade.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
So this is real, like, this is a long painting of a picture. This is an oil painting.
Right. Did Hank like his dad? Was he resentful of that?
No idea.
Oh.
Okay.
Because throughout Hank's life and his success, Lon would show up every now and then and be like, "Hey, it's your dad. I don't even want money. I'm trying to chill." But Lily hated him so much that she would get the police and come and just take him away.
Wow. Yeah. Wow. What a bitch. Okay.
Hank's first exposure to music. Let's get a little more Hank's life now.
Mm-hmm.
So Lily played organ at West Baptist Mount Olive Church and would bring Hank to every service.
Oh. At the Olive Garden.
Yes, Mount Olive Garden Baptist.
Yeah. Okay, just so Olive we're Garden, on the same page.
Baptized in the olives.
Yeah.
Lord, the breadsticks are infinite.
Oh, Lordy, Lord. And Hank really liked the church hymn. From a young age, he loved it. He was one of those kids who just yelled at the top of his lungs before he knew how obnoxious it was.
Scrawlalooyah, Lord, you've been doing things. I learned that you touched a man and made a rib.
Pretty accurate.
That's it.
What Cody was doing was what Hank was doing.
Yeah.
He's like, ruined. I am five, I am,
Yeah. You gotta have your voice break like a prepubescent.
Mm-hmm. I mean, so that's like, the only real musical influence that he had was the church shit.
Uh-huh.
It's noted here that Lon was quite proficient at the Jew's harp, but didn't really get to play around his kid too much.
Boing, boing, boing.
Yeah, that one. That fucking hitter.
I always feel like that's a derogatory term.
What, Jew's harp?
Yeah.
Kind of is.
Probably.
Okay.
His first instrument he got when he was six. This was before Lon went away. Lon went away when he was like 10 or something. But it was a harmonica. And Hank loved it. And he also was a huge fan of cowboy comics. Back in the day.
Were there many of those?
There was many of them. And back then, that was more like, you know, you would get comics along with the funnies. This is before the funnies.
Is there any we know today that have survived? I'm trying to think. Like, I feel like I know some cowboy comics,
but I
can't name any.
I didn't look into that. That's a good question.
Yeah.
I almost feel like it might have been from a previous episode, Wyatt Earp.
Ooh.
Because he was around, right? Yeah. We're talking about that period.
Yeah, yeah.
1920s, somewhere around there.
Cinch.
Yeah, so
I mean,
Wyatt
he was
Earp
born
was
in 22.
Fucking,
yeah. Or 23.
Wyatt Earp was pushing his shit back then.
Doing shitty shit in West.
Yeah, so he has this cowboy thing going. And he carried that throughout his whole life. He always looked like a cowboy.
Okay.
Even though he was in Alabama where there's no cowboys at all.
There's
for thousands of miles.
Yeah. Yes.
Swamps. Yeah. Well.
Basically swamp thing.
Yeah. And he really wanted a guitar very early on. He kind of knew that. But parents were like, no, we're poor. We cut down trees for livings.
But guitars are made of wood.
Union. Yeah, exactly.
Here's a stump and some sticks. You're a drummer now.
The first like musical inspiration to the style that he got into, though, was on the radio. There was a gentleman named Jimmy Roger, who was a country star at the time.
Okay.
And he really did this whole, like, sad, sobbing story about himself, because he actually had a pretty shitty life. His own suffering, the love life issues. He was working intense labor jobs before he got any recognition. He even had a bout with tuberculosis.
Like,
everything that Jimmy Rogers sang about was sad. So that's kind of where, like, Hank's songwriting comes from.
So that country's more like, what's his name? No, I was going to say Jack Johnson. That's completely wrong.
Robert Johnson.
Jack Johnson's a fucking douchebag.
Well, yeah. I mean, I don't think that us, with the recording qualities and everything that happened, like, distinguishing between what was country and what was blues was that apparent at the time.
Right. If someone with a guitar and saying their grievances.
Yeah.
Standard stuff.
Yeah.
Standard.
Protocol.
That's no Toby Keith, dog.
Yeah.
Fuck.
What was it? He has an alter... No, wait. Garth Brooks. He has an alter ego.
Really?
Yeah. He did this, like, fucking emo, like, haircut thing for a little bit and wore eyeliner, like a song
bitch.
What
was that called?
No way.
Yeah. I forgot what it was called. Lean. Steve showed it to me a while ago. It's fucking ridiculous. Yeah. It's like, it's a joke. And apparently he sold a shit ton of records, because country people are very loyal to their music.
Yeah.
As good or bad as it is.
Oh my God, it's Garth.
So we'll talk about Hank's living situation, which sucked, because he pretty much moved every year of his life.
Oh.
That's what it do when that's you're poor, lousy. You know? So you don't have any, like, stable friends and shit. And
they were just trailer park.
Yeah, they had the moving jobs, and it is trailer park shit.
Yeah.
The early years of his life, moving from town to town, and then it was just Lily on her own, and she was also moving all over the place for various reasons that I'm going to get into.
What did she do?
Before I get into what she did, they were in Georgiana. They moved back into, like, the main county ship of that. They kind of moved around all that. I don't know. I don't fucking know. It's
moving. It's moving around.
Yeah.
It's swampy.
But they moved moving. When they moved from Mount Olive to Georgiana, or the main area of Georgiana, that was Hank's first, like, city life, I guess. Right. There was only 1,400 people, but...
Oh, Lord.
I think like, Mount Olive at the time had, like, 120.
Yeah, when you move away from Olive Garden, there's some shell shock.
Maximum capacity, 120.
Yeah, you're out.
Things are no longer endless when you're not at the Olive Garden.
Exactly. But the first house they moved into there just caught fire, like, a weekend, and
like an Olive Garden.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about Lily again and what she did.
Yeah, I want to know what she do.
So Lily used Irene to get the attention of Lister Hill, a U.S. senator who was campaigning.
You got
to
stop with these names. You're making them up.
Lister Hill.
I'm Lister.
You're going to want to look up into Lister Hill.
It's not Lester.
No, it's Lister.
I am Lister Hill.
I'm Lister.
Not Uncle Lister.
No. Wait, can I?
It's Lister Hill.
Can I make a guess?
Okay.
So she used her daughter to blackmail young Lister Hill.
Even better.
Oh!
What's better than blackmail?
So, she was able to convince him to pull some strings. The first thing she did by befriending Lister Hill, who was campaigning for his Senate seat at this time, was she was, like, kind of a networker. She knew everyone around town. She would move into a town and just know everyone.
All right.
One of those people that, like...
Influencers.
Social
media influencers, very important.
I don't care if you live in, like, a city. I don't care if you live in, like, a small town. There's that person that's just way too happy and, like, tries to say hello to everyone.
No, this was not happy. This was not happy. She was looking for stuff.
Yeah, no, why I feel like those people that are really happy, like, they're trying to get something out of you.
Oh.
Like, they'll hand you a business card and be like, hey, yeah. Oh, I just did I learned yoga, and now you can learn yoga from me. Hey, how you doing tonight?
All right, exactly, so imagine that, but mad.
All right.
Southern.
So she was able to pull some strings and say that she would get Lister some votes.
Listerine.
Just because I know everyone. So what he did for her, the first thing he did was he made it so Lon's disability checks that were going to him in Pensacola were wired straight to her.
Nice.
Though he was paying the child support.
Disability.
Scummy piece of shit.
Yeah. And then she was able to convince Hill to talk to a landlord named Thaddeus Rose, who owned a big-ass house. Thaddeus Rose.
Again.
Yeah, that's a good name. I feel like they're... Like, it's an old name, but I do appreciate the timbre of Thaddeus. It's regal, I feel.
Thaddeus!
Yeah. So she gets Thaddeus, through Lister Hill, to rent her this house. that she has no money for. Oh. Like, kind of a good faith thing.
Right.
Like, don't worry, I'll pay the rent, but you got to trust me on this. I don't have any money right now, but I'll get you that.
Like an IOU?
Yeah.
So it's like trusting a tenant super hard.
Yeah, exactly. So with this house, to do what she wanted to do, she did what any god-loving shaved bear of a woman would do. So she started a whorehouse.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
She was a madame.
I bet she used her daughter.
A lot of her subjects using whorehouses.
No.
Yeah, you don't use your daughter for
a whorehouse. She didn't use her daughter?
I feel like that's just a general no-no.
Oh, well, I don't know. It seems pretty fucking redneck.
Yeah.
Whorehouse and a daughter? I don't know.
Well,
they like the Bible down there, Travis.
People who like the Bible also like whores.
Yeah. Well, there's a lot of whores in the Bible. Mary Magdalene.
Yeah. Yeah, Jesus' wife sucks so many dicks.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah.
Like, extra dicks.
Is it wife?
Wife. That's what they say, but no one likes to talk about it because, you know, Bible is different.
Bible is different.
Can
that be our second shirt?
Bible
is different.
Bible is different.
And then just show our four confused faces like, what?
Yeah, Bible is different and Mary was virgin.
There you go. It just says Bible is different, but then like a pile of foreskins.
All of ours.
Very biblical.
Is that the general...
That's what the Bible tells you to do.
I was going to say, is that the
chill
general...
Chill out and cut the tip of your dick off.
I was going to ask if pile was the general unit for foreskins, but...
Yeah.
No, I'm talking about just like a mess. But anyway, let's get back to
that. Yeah.
So she's running the whorehouse.
She's running the whorehouse. So keep this in mind when we talk about Hank's first guitar. When Hank was 11, he received his first guitar.
What?
It was a Silvertone guitar, which was kind of like a knockoff Gibson.
Are these euphemisms for a whore?
No.
I don't know a lot about music.
A knockoff Gibson.
Guitar is wires with wood.
Well, you mean violin?
Violin.
Violin.
The story is that Lily also used some of her weight around town to get this guitar on loan.
So way away guitar.
It was a credit based thing. Right. It was $3.50 and she
$3.50.
Yeah, $3.50. Right. And so she was going to pay it off 50 cents a month.
Right. So she walked around town. She was like, give me the Beat Boys and free my soul. I need that guitar.
So
you idiot.
50 cents at $3.50 is a 7-month obligation.
Yeah, exactly.
Wow.
But one thing to be noted here is that there's a lot of folks who wanted to be part of the Hank Williams lore. So we don't actually know if that's true. There was a lot of other people involved with Hank's life, like uncles and various other town folks that said that they bought him his first guitar.
I feel if your mom has a whorehouse, you just have a lot of uncles.
Yeah.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
So Hank did the opposite of what any smart child should do at the age of 11, getting a guitar, who's been asking for a guitar for all of his darn life.
He got a triangle.
No, he got all excited with his new instrument, and Cowboy Hank ran outside of the house to a nearby field where there were cows to let off some steam and excitement, and he jumped onto a little baby calf and tried to wrestle it, and the calf just kicked him to the ground and broke his arm. He wasn't able to play guitar for a long time.
All right, just coming from a family that had a lot of farms, you don't sneak up on anything that has hooves.
Oh, no.
That's just a general rule. Never sneak up on anything that has a hoof.
Yep. Yeah, he tried to wrestle that thing to the ground and was trounced.
Yo, what up, dog? I'm gonna wrestle you. I'm gonna be a WrestleMania.
Don't wrestle things that have hooves.
Nope.
Good rule, regardless of where you live.
So we'll talk about Hank's playing.
Please.
Now.
Yeah, I wanna know how he does. He uses two fingers, he uses a billion fingers, he uses a lot of fingers.
He uses every squid digit he has.
All right. Squid didgeridoo.
The legend goes that he learned from a gentleman named T-Tot.
T-Tot.
Yes.
Okay.
A regular guitar playing busking gentleman named Rufus Payne, or better known as T-Tot, would teach Hank how to play guitar and told him the importance of being consistent and just kind of holding a beat down.
Was T-Tot black?
T-Tot was black.
Hey. I feel like all the best guitar players, you know, in the back in the day were black.
They learned, yeah.
So they had that fucking ray.
I like Muddy. Muddy's a good guy.
Muddy Waters?
Muddy Waters, yeah.
Yeah.
Great.
I mean, he's a little later, right?
He was later. No, yeah. Well, he was kind of like
early,
similar time.
Yeah.
Really.
Oh, really?
I do like Muddy.
Is that his real name?
Muddy?
Muddy Waters?
No, it's just a nickname.
Yeah, it's a nickname.
Yo, they're cool name. Like a lot of the old like jazz players and like blues players had awesome nicknames. Like Muddy Waters.
Fats.
Fats Domino.
Fats was
Lead Belly. Like, Lead just Valley. Really
Jelly Roll Morton.
Yeah, Jelly Roll Morton.
That's a cool name.
Yeah, they had the awesome they knew how to do nicknames back then.
Now it's just let's get that back. We were already talking about Irving Rames. Like, yeah. let's start a wave of, like, decent nicknames coming back.
Well, I mean, like, look at all the rappers that are out today with the word little.
Yeah, or young, spelled young. with just a U.
Yeah.
That's his fucking Instagram handle.
Me?
No,
you're not young, Reagan.
No, I'm not. Oh, that's my Snapchat. But I made that when I was like 18.
Oh, sure you
did. I regret it so much.
Oh, young Reggie.
Oh, sorry if I doxed you.
Young Reggie.
Tom, save us if we doxed him.
No. Yeah, everyone should have it. Everyone, send your dick pics. And your tip pics.
Yeah, everyone. Yeah.
Or both. Yeah.
I just want Mike's Instagram to be illicit. Snapchat.
All right.
You old, you 30 fuck.
You 30 fuck. All right, bringing this
musically.
Back in.
Oh, I'm the youngest person here now. Musically. Y'all don't even know what that is.
No, you work at Hearst. No. What are you talking about?
It's a karaoke machine for children.
Oh.
Musically? Yeah.
Musically.
That sucks.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is that just Kids Bop in a console?
Kind of.
Kids Bop it's also, 14.
It's also music.ly.
Yeah.
Ooh. Oh, I hate that.
Yeah. And then you basically karaoke your songs and you know. Pretend you're not getting hard. Like
all right,
you are.
Maybe
you're learning about
maybe
it.
Maybe we'll do that at the end of this recording.
Okay.
So people often spoke about T-Tot like he took Hank under his wing, and Hank really looked up to him. But in reality, Hank never really learned T-Tot's name, even. And would
I feel
refer
like T-Tot
to him,
didn't learn T-Tot's name.
I don't know. Well, he would just refer to him as this old Negro and would pay him like 10 to 15 cents to have lessons.
Wow.
This is also contextualized.
Good mentor.
I'm sure this is some pretty racist shit, but that was kind of normal back then.
I know, but it's
not
fucked.
To say it's right. It's
yeah,
fucked
yeah,
up.
Fuck. Yeah.
Racist as hell.
Yeah.
But at least you're using it to better yourself.
At least he's paying him.
Probably paying him.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I don't know. That's terrible, though.
But later in Hank's career, I think he like asked around and tried to find him. Like
okay.
Hank kind of redeemed himself. This is like when he used to just say this old Negro. It was like before he was big. He kind of grew up and talked about T-Tot. Like he found out his name and
like I owe this dude some.
Just because I've been wondering about
he
it
got
for
cool
a minute.
About it.
Now.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah,
Tom. Just because I've been wondering about this for a minute now, how do you spell that name?
T-E-E space T-O-T.
There's a space in your name.
T-Tot.
Tater Tot.
So T-Tot died in 1939 and is buried in an unmarked grave. So
that's a bad grave.
Hank could have probably found it and dug him up and
mark
put him
it
in
up.
A grave.
Yeah. Oh, well, there was a parade thrown for Hank.
Put
I'm
an emoji
ahead of
on
there
it.
There was a parade thrown for Hank in 1950 and no one knew T-Tot was dead and he had people try to look for him.
Oh no.
Yeah, definitely.
That's like some Elvis shit, because Elvis stole all the shit from black people.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I don't know. I feel like... I feel like the early guitarist people from, you know, the 30s and 40s, all of it's fucking stolen from black people.
Yeah.
Fuck that shit.
Yeah.
Well, it sucks.
Chuck Berry, yeah.
White people, well, no, they're not even, they weren't even good at big band. That was all black people, too.
Well, you had, his name?
Some white
people. People thought Chuck Berry was white for the longest time.
Jews and black people.
Jews were good with big band, yeah. All right, so let's talk more about Hank and some dumb shit. Now, Hank was sent to his cousin's place sometimes to get out of the boarding house. That
sexual.
Was, yeah, the shitty zone.
Yeah.
He would spend long bouts of time away from Lily's whorehouse and stay with her brother-in-law's, Walter McNeely.
Oh, why hang out with whores?
Walter McNeely,
excuse
me.
Brothers.
Yeah. He spent time with his cousin JC fishing and playing guitar, yodeling his stupid fucking head off, and drinking.
Okay,
he started drinking at 11 pretty hard.
Wow.
If you're drinking at 11, there's only one fish you fish for when you're drinking at 11. Catfish.
Oh, yeah, dude. You gotta reach your 11-year-old hand into that fucking...
Let me tickle your gills and eat you.
Yeah, you just had you don't have to drink. You stop drinking for one day. You get the shakes. Put it in the mud.
Ooh,
get that catfish.
You guys, that is one food I have yet to eat.
Catfish?
Eaten?
Delicious.
Eaten? Catfish?
Yeah, it's pretty good.
Does it eat?
You ever eaten catfish?
Yeah, it's great.
Yeah,
it's one of the best fish.
Yeah, really
like
good.
That monkfish.
Yeah.
Monkfish can be a little funky, I've heard.
Monkfish is awesome, dude.
Never had.
Monk and cat.
I've heard monk is weird.
No one cares about this.
Okay.
No one who likes us cares about fish.
Everyone cares about fish.
It's a down south delicacy, catfish po' boys, right, Travis?
Yeah, you just put anything on po' boy. You make a po' boy, you have a good time with
a po' boy. You can make a po' boy po' boy. Yeah, just have that.
You can take a piece of bread and ladle it up, right, and make a good old po' boy.
Mayonnaise up a piece of bread, put in a sandwich, you got a po' boy po' boy.
I feel like the most authentic po' boy is a butter po' boy.
I was going to say mayo po' boy.
Some crazy enough to call it a butter roll. But we know it all. We know what the butter do when it inside it become a po' boy.
Super tangent. The world's most economic meal is called the toast sandwich.
Ah, yes.
It's an English dish which consists of a piece of toast between bread.
That's hard.
Very sexual.
All right, very English. Let's go back to America because this is not Britain. This is America.
That was fun, though. That's a fun.
It was fun, but this is America. This is America. Freedom, America.
All right, so let's go to Montgomery, shall we?
Yeah.
Lurbalima.
Now, y'all heard of Montgomery before.
Yeah,
dog.
That's where MLK did his best milking.
That's also where, Thomas Jefferson. That's where he chilled.
That's where he chilled?
Montgomery.
That's where he relaxed.
So Lily moved the family.
No, that was Monticello. I'm all wrong.
Jesus, you're fucked. You fucked me. Yeah.
It's up to Tom to save if he wants.
You're done. Lily moved the family and the whorehouse to Montgomery for some reason in 1936. Bigger city. Mm-hmm. Hank was 13.
The whores are part of the family there.
I guess. Okay. Well, they're in the house.
Lovely. Yeah. In-house whores.
Yep. Hank was 13 when he started playing out in the streets and selling peanuts and shining shoes.
All at the same time?
Yep.
He was playing,
he would play to get attention.
Eight arms? Was he an octopi?
No. This is what you do. Back then, music was used like as a marketing thing a lot. Like as soon as radio was big, commercials.
Payola. All right.
Yeah, jingles were huge.
Yeah. Oh.
So he, being a smart kid, he started playing guitar on street corners with the peanuts like next to him, and then he'd be like, "Oh yeah, if anyone wants to buy some peanuts after they watch
these
him.
Are for sale."
And then after he made the peanut sale, he would offer for an extra cent or two to try new shoes.
Are these roasted peanuts?
I don't know.
Mm. I got the peanut. I'm gonna shine your shoes.
So we got young Hanch. He's selling peanuts.
Peanuts.
Yes.
He's selling peanuts.
He's out there playing guitar. He's shining shoes. He's very smart and stations himself in front of the Jefferson Davis Hotel. Now, at the top of this hotel is the office for the radio station WSFA.
Can I just mention the Jefferson Davis Hotel?
Yes.
The president of the Confederacy.
Yes.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, think, of the time period.
Yeah, well, down south.
Also, what was my question?
What the fuck was my question?
I don't know,
I forget. Keep going.
Who let the dogs out?
That.
He even managed to get some of the executives' attention because he was there so consistently. Hank did not like going to school.
So he's shining shoes and throwing peanuts.
Yeah, that's right. A year later, he writes a song called the WPA Blues, Work Progress Administration, which is a federal program that most people in the area were involved with because it had to do with infrastructure and putting people to work.
Yeah, that was an FDR program.
Yes.
Hmm.
30s, right?
No, well, he boosted it because this is pre...
This is pre-FDR?
No, excuse me. This is 36. So, yeah, it was an FDR thing. So he writes a song called the WPA Blues, and he plays it at a talent show, and of course he wins because he's Hank Wilms.
Right.
How wow.
So Hank Wilms wins $15 at a talent show and then marches his ass over to the Jefferson Davis Hotel and says, "Hey, I just won a talent show. Why don't you put me on the air?" And it worked.
Okay.
It's a premium initiative.
Big balls. Started throwing him time slots where there weren't advertisers and stuff. They would just let him play and do his thing. They introduced him as a singing kid because, you know, no one had imagination back there except for jazz singers.
I shall call him the singing kid.
Yeah.
That was really his name, the singing kid.
Yeah, man. And he was literally a singing kid.
Right.
Where's my beer? God damn it.
There you go.
Hard.
I'm ruined right now.
This is your beer.
So now his career takes off pretty darn quick after this point because he's able to get the radio time and the attention that he needs, and he starts playing shows.
Yeah.
They actually get him to start doing commercial reads and putting him on the bigger...
Jangles.
Yeah, big jangles.
Jangus.
Mm-hmm. So that's kind of like how he got his foot in the door. All radius.
All right.
He puts together a backing band called the Drifting Cowboys. Mm-hmm. That name stayed, even though it had a whole bunch of different members in it, and he would stop it at some points. And that was always his backing band, the Drifting Cowboys.
Drifting Cowboys.
Because he loved cowboys.
Yeah.
Cow
punk. Was this WPRW?
WSFA.
AKA Radio Disney.
No.
That's where he started.
Oh, God.
That's where he started. Yes. Radio Disney.
That's not true.
That is where he started. I called in.
Can I drink this beer real quick in honor of Radio Disney not being alive anymore?
Oh, it's dead.
No way. Cool. Okay.
I phoned into Radio Disney one time. Let's
Yeah, you
it.
Did.
Cheers, mate.
Good. Stay in the ground. So hard. So hard.
That's a good pregnant pause in the cast.
Well, next Roast Modern Podcast will be on Radio Disney.
Which will be dead.
That's why we're doing
Can we do a roast of Radio Disney?
Let's do it. Let's see. Back into this. So he starts playing events around Alabama and Florida. And Lily is like, yo, my son's so cool. I'm going to get him a new guitar. And as a bonus, I'll be his manager and his agent and take care of all of his money.
That doesn't sound like a good idea.
No.
Yeah, it sucks because, you know, keep in mind of how cold-hearted that bitch is, sending her husband away to Pensacola and, you know, whorehouse. I mean,
yeah, sounds like a really terrible idea.
Yeah.
Fuck, we just chugged the beer, so now I'm burping.
All burpees. Yeah, shit. When the band would tour, though, his sister Irene would follow them, and she was like the proxy manager. So she had her orders from Lily to keep shit straight, and Irene would just take all the Hank's money that he would get because he drank too much. That was also another reason that they did this. You can argue that it was bad that they were taking all of his money, but they were kind of holding on to it, some of it for him.
Well, yeah, they saved his life. They extended a life for, like, you know, maybe 10 years.
Yeah, because
Boyo was ethanol powered.
He got fucked up. He was moonshine.
Yeah.
Real bad.
I mean, we all drank underage. I'm sure.
I did.
Almost everyone did.
Not.
Shut up, Cody. You did.
No.
He actually didn't. He's a bitch ass.
No, I made him drink underage.
No.
You drank when we were at the house party. You were under 21.
Yeah, I was, but I don't remember.
See, you don't remember.
No, yeah.
So drunk.
So drunk.
We did do that. Thank you. Ooh, that's a crusty memory.
Yeah, dog.
That's weird how that flakes off.
I just got
like
you woke.
That. Yeah.
But,
that's weird.
So, but like drinking at 12?
It's a little rough.
That's a rough.
Yeah. Rough. I waited until at least like 19.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What about you guys?
Me? No, first drink I had was 12.
Oh, wow.
Really?
I wasn't a drinker, though. I was just like, first time I had a drink and got drunk.
Well, the first time I actually had a drink was when I was 6.
Wow.
Oh, yeah?
Yes. And there's a story behind this, and I'll tell it right now.
Sure.
So I had a great aunt. She worked for the New York Times. She was like a very, very feminist movement. She was the first editor at New York Times.
Oh, good story.
Hey, I'm telling this.
He's doing
I'm
it.
Telling the history.
He's doing
All right,
it.
Fine, go.
Okay. So she was very loaded. But she used to mix her gin and tonics in Sprite bottles. Huh. So I,
oh Lord,
as a young man,
oh Lord,
as a young boy, when I was like, hey, there's Sprite in her fridge. I'm gonna pour myself a drink.
Did you say it with that deep timbre, like, oh Sprite?
Yeah,
yes.
Sprite.
I
yes.
am 6, and this is definitely Sprite.
And you know, I was a tubby boy, so I used to chug Sprite. I poured a whole thing of Sprite, and I like chugged it down. Like, almost all the way to the bottom.
Without realizing?
Well, and then I didn't know what it was. It was like, and I went up to my mom. I was like,
okay.
This Sprite's bad!
Travis.
Oh, yeah.
Shit.
And I was just wasted the entire night. They locked me in a room.
You know, what? Dude,
my mom called, like, the hospital. And like, no, just lock him in a room.
Like, that's how you did it in 1994.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Good times.
Yeah, so that's my first drinking experience.
Hell yeah. Let's talk about some misery.
Sure.
We all like misery, right?
Chocolate.
Misery loves company. Sometimes comes with a pretty face.
Sexual
half the time.
Being. Yeah.
Sexual.
Half the time.
Half the time. Exactly.
We're going to talk about Audrey. Excuse me. Audrey.
Audrey.
Sounds
Audrey.
Like a troublesome name.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Audrey Mae Shepherd Guy was Hank's first wife.
All right. One more time.
What?
Audrey Mae Shepherd Guy.
Too many spaces in
the
fucking
name. Wait, she was a shepherd guy?
Hold on, I'll get to the guy thing in a minute. There, that actually has a little bit of something.
Like Fieri.
Well, she was married.
Oh.
So Guy was her husband's name.
His name is Guy Guy.
Yeah. And his name is Guy Guy. And this is Hank's first wife and the inspiration for almost every agonizing heartache song he ever wrote.
Okay.
It's all about Audrey.
All about.
They met in 1943 while Hank was touring with a traveling medicine show. If you don't know what a medicine show is, that was basically a giant advertisement that would go from town to town and kind of do like a radio type special thing where they would bring acts and the town would come and watch this show happen.
So it's a variety hour or something?
A little variety. It's very vaudevillian. Okay. It's like where they were like camp up in towns. Like it wasn't a scheduled thing. So they would just hit towns. And
it was like the Three Stooges and shit did that.
Yes. They were earlier, but yeah.
Okay.
Medicine shows were actually very popular up until like 1955-ish.
Yeah. Was he exempt from World War One for whatever reason? Because of
World War Two. Yes, World War II.
World War Two.
Yeah, sorry. I did. I did a shit ton of research and putting this all together. So please ask questions like that, because what happened was the Drifting Cowboys that I mentioned before. Uh-huh. One of the reasons shit didn't work out with them is because all those dudes got drafted and he couldn't even serve. And he wanted to serve because he had a lot of pride in his country.
But he had that back.
Oh, yeah, I was about to say that's back.
Yeah, the spinal bifida.
Yeah, he was like, my neck and my back, my pussy and my crack.
That was a Hank Williams original.
Hank Williams, yeah. That was Hank Williams.
That was pain. That was true pain. So they met on this medicine tour. What happened was is wherever it was traveling and wherever she was, Hank was doing his salesman bit, like he's playing and he's talking to the audience because he knew how to sell shit. He was very charming.
Like Steve Urkel.
Yeah. And he talked to this woman. I think it went something along the lines of he's selling this like miracle snake oil shit.
Oh, it's one of those.
Right. Yeah. It's total bullshit.
Miracle Whip.
Yeah. And he's talking to people and there's a whole bunch of people around. Audrey's one of them. And he does, hey, ma'am, I think you need some of this. And then does a double take and said, I don't think you do at all, actually. One of those. And they kind of just fell in love there.
Oh.
And they became a unit pretty immediately, even though she was married and had a child.
Unit.
Yes, one unit.
My unit. Oh, my unit.
And they were like dead in love, but in the most white trash way you could imagine.
Right.
Like they spent all their time together and it was, there was no just chilling. It was either like them hurting each other.
Or banging.
They're banging. They'd make up. They had violent sex all over the place. Or they would
fucking.
Just, yeah. Or it was just, you know, get out of this house. I never want to see you again. Mm. Attitude, you know, a lot of that. Yeah, get out of here.
Get.
G-I-T.
So Ank.
Ank.
Yeah. This is the British bullcat. Ank. So what happened now is Ank has got Audrey.
Oi.
Right.
In it.
Hank introduces Audrey to Lily.
In it.
Warning Audrey that his mom would be an asshole.
In it.
According to the story, Hank said to Audrey, you know she's gonna say something to you. She's gonna say something like, where'd you get this whore?
Oh, you did it, oi, mate.
Did just that. Where did you get this whore? First thing out of Lily's mouth when she saw Audrey. That kind of people were dealing. Where'd Main you get this Street. Whore?
It's very nice.
In it.
They became a musical duo as well. She joined the Drifting Cowboys. But it didn't last long because he lost his job at the radio station for showing up drunk too many times.
How many is too many?
Five too many for a Southerner.
Five too many?
I couldn't find any record of that, but it was 12 too many. Problem. Yeah, because I'm sure those guys were drinking on the job all the time, but he came in sloshed. Yeah. So Hank actually ended up quitting music after that. And him and Audrey moved down to Mobile, Alabama.
Alabama. Is it Mobile? Is it mobile?
Mobile.
I don't know.
That's a rough joint. I feel like I've driven through there with my family once.
I feel like it's a place I wouldn't want to go. Named after shit.
I feel like that's where like a lot of the southern, like, you know, the southern racist tensions of the 60s come from is Mobile.
Yeah.
I think that's where like Ruby, like the first, let me know if I'm wrong. I think that's where like the first integrated like black chick in a white school happened and her name was Ruby.
I think I remember that.
Yeah, let me know if I'm wrong.
And it might be, but
you remember that from your vampiric life.
Because I've existed for a long time. And actually, one of my favorite places in Alabama. I did a review on Yelp. I did a review on Googis.
What is this?
Beeper, Alabama.
Beeper,
Alabama.
It's before Mobile.
You suck. Okay. You're the worst.
That was a dad joke.
Can we stop? Yeah, well,
thank you for tuning into the Roast Mortem podcast. This will be our last broadcast ever.
There's no way.
Hit me
we're
on
coming.
The beeper, dog.
We're not coming back.
Me up,
from
dog.
That.
Hit me up on the beep, beeper.
Right, see
beeper.
What you did.
You could have said pager and made that way less ghetto.
Shut up.
Yeah, true.
But you made me think if there was a beeper Alabama for a hot minute.
Tom, I'll hear more about this boy.
All right, that's what I'm getting back in. So both Hank and Audrey worked as welders in Mobile, Alabama, but Hank's back was too fucked up for him to do the hard labor.
Why do I always feel like welders have fucked backs?
I don't know. I know a couple of welders that are just very strong, sensual men, keeping their eyes protected. What was that CNC Music Factory where it's just a bunch of welders? You know,
the music video?
Yeah, yeah. Good stuff.
I don't know what song that is, but it's sexual.
Right. So Audrey, I'll put it this way. She's a hard bitch.
Oh.
She sucks, like, on record.
Like an idiot.
Total idiot. All
right.
Abusive as well. Like, Hank sucked, but she sucked right back at him.
Right.
But she was 100% responsible for Hank's musical career because he was just going to drink himself to death and be a welder. And work his way through it.
Okay.
And she was just like, no, let's go back to Montgomery. Let's start the band up again. You got talents. And it worked. Fucking worked.
Well, that's good.
Yeah, no, she did some good stuff.
Good for him.
I'll talk about their marriage quickly. December 15th, 1944, 10 days after Audrey's official divorce goes through from the serviceman, Guy.
The guy that actually served in World War II?
Yes.
And was like fighting over there and while she was fucking porking.
She's porking around.
Fucking...
Onomatopoeia.
So the two of them got married at a Texaco gas station.
Nice. Was the Hess not available that evening?
I don't even know, but it's I wouldn't say sad. I would say rotund.
Rotund.
Audrey, do you take this man as your lawfully wedded husband?
Can I get six on number five?
$6 on number five.
That's filling up two tanks back then.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah. Whoa.
Yeah, was that a big rig? Jeez.
Dude, it's crazy, dude. Gang married at a gas station. Beautiful thing. Getting married, yes. No, but the marriage technically wasn't even legal because back in Alabama, a divorce would require a 60-day waiting period before you got married again. And they only waited 10 days.
Red tape.
Mm-hmm.
Fuck Alabama.
And they could have known that and just be like, hey, let's just like wait. And he's just like, no, wait. You cannot tell me how to live this life that we have.
Hiram does not wait.
Yeah.
Hiram is for here and now.
It's for Hiram now.
I can't wait to consummate this marriage, even though I've been consummated before the marriage.
Yeah. Even though we've been blasting fingers left and right. But the relationship, like I said before, was a straight up nightmare zone. And not even just for Hank and Audrey, but also Audrey and Lily and Irene being caught in fist fights several times.
Oh, shit.
This was trashy stuff. This was
Jerry Springer.
Hank's career comeback. After some shows and getting some other radio play, because he was able to go to smaller stations and kind of get some spots, Audrey talked to the folks at WSFA. God damn it. Why can't I say letters?
I know. It's hard. Letters are tough, dude.
Fuck it, man.
She convinced them to let Hank back and get his old job. And he had built up the reputation of kind of like showing up on time places and not drinking so much.
Oh!
He did like try to go sober a few times.
Like, well, by sober you mean I did a shot after I did brush my teeth. That's it.
I'll get into that later.
That's good for the enamel.
Yeah, it is.
Oh, delicious. So the radio went really well. And he also sold songbooks.
Hymns.
No. Yeah. Well, okay, what's so what happened? Back in the day, if you didn't have a record label, there was no way that you were going to record anything.
Yeah.
So this is before he signed with anyone. So one way self-made musicians would do that was they would write their songs out in songbooks, kind of like tablature, you know, sheet music.
I feel like that's...
That makes me want to ask my next question. What was Hank Williams' media primarily sold on?
Up until this point?
Yeah.
It was the songbooks.
So there's no records or
and radio.
No cylinders.
No, that does happen. He gets records. He gets vinyl presses.
Okay, so he gets vinyl
press.
That's how you would experience Hank Williams in this juncture in time would be vinyl press.
His biggest sales were technically jukeboxes.
Oh, okay, jukebox played
the vinyl stuff.
With vinyl.
That's where his highest numbers came off.
Interesting.
Right, so that was bars that
that's
would
how
just
you'd
like
enjoy
run
his, him.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. He would get radio play, which also had royalties. The records would sell a lot, but
so
it was
usually,
also, it was just the country world.
Right.
But you know, if it was via jukebox, his main demographic was a bar full of drunks.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
Okay.
Also, to paint that picture, at that time, all the records were 78 RPM, and it was just two songs. It was an A side and a B side. There was no album to buy.
Oh, fucking wow.
Yeah, yeah. So people, like, the album sales didn't really count so much because it was mostly radio play and the jukeboxes, and people would play the shit out of them. I mean, like, it like crazy amounts of money came in from that shit.
Right. All right, so listen up, Williamsburg, Brooklyn. If,
what?
Yeah, so listen up. This is our message out for all you people that live in Williamsburg. You think you're cool with your vinyl, but up until the 20th century, songbooks.
Yeah, get some songbooks. Yeah,
so get some songbooks.
Fucking dicks.
Oh, wow. Oh, you're so cool. You got vinyls. Guess what? Find someone that can play piano. Find someone that can play guitar and sing it.
All right. What was that movie, Tropical Thunder? Thunder?
Yeah.
All right. What was Ben Stiller's other movie? Like this Happy Jack, Retarded Jack? You know that, like,
yeah, Happy Jack.
Happy Jack. Yeah, the stupid bowl cut thing.
Uh-huh.
I probably saw like 24 dudes in Greenpoint last night with outfits that are very, very similar to that, with the addition of a feather earring.
Oh
my God.
It is not a good look, gentlemen.
Earring?
It's not a good look.
Like, I'm trying to get one of those.
Yeah.
Stop.
No, stop.
You're fired. A little George Michael.
You think you get laid?
Yeah, don't George it. Don't George it, Doug.
Since the radio was going well and they're selling the songbooks and all that shit's going fine, they decide to try to get into what they call the Grand Opry.
Oh.
Now,
the Grand Opry.
Now, the Grand Opry was a
is
play
there
on,
an E in Grand Opry?
There, it's a Y.
So there's no E.
And it's exactly what it sounds like.
Opry.
Opry isn't some word you haven't heard before. It is Southern opera.
Right.
The Grand Opry.
Like down south, they don't play the piano. They
piano.
Play the pian.
Play the pian, man.
They play the pian.
The pian.
They play the keys.
Play the keys.
They tickle the ivories down south. They don't play the piano.
They tickle the ivories. So the Grand Ole Opry, that was a big deal. It was in Nashville. And it was a big radio circuit that would actually play on NBC's station after they did some kind of, some popular show that was all classical music.
Okay.
And this was a half-hour show that was broadcast nationally on the NBC radio station.
Okay.
Basically the country's ultimate exposure to the opera. I mean, country music. And one other thing to add is that they actually did televise eventually, too. I think in 1951, they were able to film these events at the Grand Opry. And the way the Opry worked was that they would have the same acts come on, and they would kind of change it up, and they would have them do songs together. And, like, it was like a celebrity fest.
Right.
Like, here's all the hot dudes. Roy Acuff, he coming up here.
Hot dudes! Roy Acorn.
So this was, if you want to make it in country, this is where you need to be.
Do you think that being NBC, because I think their base has always been at Rockefeller Center.
Mm-hmm.
30 Rock?
Yeah, 30 Rock. Do you think that they were just taking a piss? Or were they just like, oh, it's the Opry? You know what I mean? It's New York. New York people.
New York City.
Like, they have operas. Oh, yeah we're going to do the Opry for them.
That's one of the nicest things I've ever done, is just going to an opera in New York City.
So the first attempt to get into the Grand Opry did not go so well, even though they had the build-up, and people really liked Hank Williams for just playing around and shit, and everyone knew who he was. He kind of slipped back into the reputation of being a drunken asshole.
And it's
like a family show. So they're like, nah, no thanks. How you doing? Rose Acuff Publishing.
Fuck your names.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, shit.
Now, this is Fred Rose and Roy Acuff, two country stars at the time. Actually, Roy Acuff was the country star. Fred Rose was the publisher and songwriter,
it
not really
like
a performer.
A porn publishing.
Right. So Fred Rose was like a big to-do at the time. Yeah. He had his hands everywhere, and
Freddie. He
got wind of Hank trying to do some stuff, and I guess
wind
he went and saw
Hank.
Wind of Hank.
Wind of
accepted
Hank.
Wind of Hank.
Catching that wind.
Yeah. So he signed a deal with Hank, and it was a recording deal and also a songwriting deal where I think Fred Rose wanted to write some songs for him to play, and they would record a bunch of stuff and together.
Yeah.
Like, he wanted to be partnered up.
Wanted to make more Rose Gold things, because that's what's in.
Rose gold stuff?
Rose gold. It's all of rose gold.
So this went extremely well for a few years, and Hank got a whole bunch of number one hits on the radio.
Premium number one.
Money started coming in. Good old stuff. And Fred Rose, about a year after they had put out a few singles, went to the Grand Ole Opry folks and was just like, you gotta let Hank on. He's the shit. So that's how he got involved in the Grand Ole Opry. And The Opry also traveled.
They're carnies.
They're pretty much carnies.
Carnies. Moving.
It was filmed and recorded in Nashville, but I think it was only, I don't know the schedule. Like, they would take time off and go places with the whole act. Mm-hmm. Like, everyone who was on the show, all these country stars, and they bring them all in one place. And Hank quickly became the top. The first day he was at the Opry, there was a 6 encore setup. People wouldn't shut the fuck up until Hank was out. Wow. And no one even, this is how big he was in the country scene.
How do you think they got all these country acts from town to town? Do you think they just put like a couple 40s in the next town and they all just like ran?
No, they all just drove Cadillacs. I'm not even kidding.
Oh, really?
Yeah. They would just take as many Cadillacs as they needed. Yeah.
It's pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty choice.
But Hank really never knew how to handle responsibility. For example, he was offered to play on a pretty big radio show in D.C. and he got the boys from the band over there, called them up, like, hey, we got this fucking sweet radio show. Let's go do it. And the guys are like, we don't even want to work with you anymore because you're an asshole and you're drunk. And he's just like, no, I'll just fly you out there and I'll meet you there. And then they all showed up to the radio station and Hank was just drunk somewhere and they could never find him.
Oh, wow.
Good times.
I got a feeling called the blues. Lord,
all right, let's talk about Hank and his silliness.
If you want.
Silly Hank.
So Hank never had a driver's license, but that was never a problem for him. He would just buy cars and drive them around. And he also did desperately need glasses, but he never wore them. So, you know, there's that guy just driving around hammered.
Hello.
Without glasses. Never even took a test. Him and Audrey, they kind of like cheated on each other like it was their job. They were just slinging that Poonie and the Peenie around.
Poonie and Peenie.
I just came up with that.
Yeah, Poonie,
like Peenie.
It. Yeah.
It's usually Phallic and Yannick, but...
Yannick.
You're talking about Yanni?
Yeah, I was going to say Yannick.
No. When something's phallic, it's penis-like. But when something's Yannick, it's vagina-like.
It's opposite.
It's like the fleshy envelope.
Yeah, when people call like a vagina thing phallic, it's like, no, that's yonic, not phallic.
Yeah, fair enough. So they was cheating, and that's the way they lived it. They also kind of redefined what white trash does with money at this time.
What does white trash do with money, Thomas?
Shotguns.
Now, 1947, they were making
moonshine.
Roughly 15 to 20 grand a year. And
NASCARs.
At that time, that was closer to 150 a year, 200.
Yeah, that's a lot of skrill.
Yeah. Yeah, like money from 47 to now is about, it's worth about 10 times the amount.
Yeah.
So if they're making, even if you're making 10 grand, you're making $100,000.
Getting hard.
It's all good. Buy a house.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Super cheap in the South.
Yeah.
No income tax down there, really.
Mm-hmm. So let's talk about Hank and Audrey's first divorce.
Hank Audrey.
The first one.
What would their couple name be?
Hawdry. Or Ank.
I like that.
Ankry.
I like Ank.
Ank. Yeah. Ank.
Ankh. She claims he was violent and drunk, and when he got his attorney to be involved, basically they just read all the complaints against him, and he looked at it and said, well, she does all that to me.
Oh! what an airtight countersuit, my fucking God.
Yeah, I mean, it's a very hillbilly thing. Like, why'd you do that? I didn't do that.
Yeah.
You did it.
No, you.
That is every episode of the fucking Jerry Springer show.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, this divorce...
No, you got me pregnant, Travis.
Pregos.
Dude, what happened, Cody? I'm pretty drunk. You want to get pregnant?
Yeah, you hosed your sesmond in my gills, and now I have eggs.
Are we talking about the Shape of Water?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, the Shape of Water. So the divorce was never actually finalized, even though it was dragged on for about 3 months.
Like the Shape of Water.
And then they got back together, as they do, as the hillbillies like to do.
Why? Yeah. Why so?
Dude, sometimes you just got to throw that dick in
like
your old...
It's like the rule of the American South.
Like I said before, she was the inspiration for all the awful, awful songwriting.
Yeah.
Like, the lyrically, you know? It's good songwriting, but it's, you know, it's all about awful things.
Hank Williams probably just had a penis that was, like, curved 90 degrees to the right, so it just boomerang back into that wicked snatch.
You do the hook shot.
That's right.
Ooh.
I'm bouncing a little bit out of the timeline here, but here's an example of the heart feltness. Now, I'm going to talk about the song Cold, Cold Heart.
Okay.
Is that Coldplay?
Wake Coldplay may have covered it, because it is possibly one of the most covered songs of all time.
Mm,
In fact, that song that he wrote, made Tony Bennett's career.
Oh, okay. Shit.
Yeah.
So Tony was like, wake up to see you. I'll see you tomorrow.
That's not how the song goes.
Try to chill, but you're dumb.
Keep going.
Nobody said I was
different.
Keep
padding for time, Travis.
Now I try to eat an egg
sandwich
alone.
Is that R.E.M.?
Alone.
No. All right, well, shut up. Here's what's going on. So he writes Cold, Cold Heart, and it's actually a B-side for one of the finals they would send to the radio stations.
In it.
But a few times in his career, the B-side, keep in mind the vinyls were 78s and there was one song on each side.
The B-side.
The B-side was kind of just like you put the least favorite of that, you know, of the recording session on there.
Your B material.
But a lot of it was ended up being the bigger radio plays. This is one of them. Cold, Cold Heart was never supposed to be a big hit, but it was his most fiscally huge song out there. He made so much money off
that's
that.
That's a very, very fun thing to happen when your B-side is more popular.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I mean,
very rare, very fun thing.
No, well, one of the ones that stands out the most to me for a B-side is... Oh, come on, Cody.
No.
Because I'm from a serious musical tape.
The soundtrack to The Mummy was not a B-side.
It wasn't The Mummy. It was... But canoom boom boom back down boom boom boom.
That's the Seinfeld theme. I don't
That was the B side.
Yeah. You should have heard the A side. It was just a pipe organ.
Jerry screaming.
What's the deal?
Yeah, so
airline food.
So Cold, Cold Heart was his biggest hit by far, and even Norah Jones covered it in like 2002 and
how
like,
lovely.
Macy Gray.
Yeah, she charted with it. Macy Gray may have. I don't know, but probably. A lot of people have. It made Tony Bennett's career because when he was up and coming, Fred Rose, the publisher, shopped it around the Tin Pan Alley of New York City, and the publishers up there liked it. And
Tin
it won.
Pan Alley. I haven't heard that phrase in a fucking decade.
It's been a minute.
Yeah. Fred Durst Alley.
Tell him what it is, because I don't.
It was basically a bunch of studio execs.
Yeah.
That had offices in this particular place.
Like proto payola.
Yeah. So Fred Rose shopped that song around. That made Tony Bennett's career. Not a lot of people know that. In fact, more people know the Tony Bennett version of that song. And the song was written about an abortion.
You asked us to do this during the podcast and I couldn't get it.
Yeah, man. What happened was is that he was away on tour. Audrey discovered that she was Pregos. She already had one child with him that was Randall that later becomes Hank 2.
Randall, yes. A.K.A. Hank 2.
Yeah.
Rank 2.
What happened was is that she found out she was pregnant. Hank's away on tour. She gets an illegal abortion.
Oh.
Which, in Hank's eyes, because he's a Christian or a Baptist, not cool at all. All
right.
So that's what he's singing about. The only reason he found out about it is because it was botched.
So the
abortion part was successful, but she had this real nasty infection that just ruined her body. God. And that's how they found out about it.
Was it a beast infection?
It took me a second. A beast infection. Oh, I got a nasty beast infection.
I got a beast from the east.
Yep. So that's rough.
Infection.
Yeah, so that's what that song is written about, because Hank found out because she was in the hospital and hated her for doing that because he did not believe in abortion. How could you do this to my son or child?
My unborn.
Son or child. No, son or daughter. I am fucked.
Like a David Koreshian.
Yeah. What? Yeah, Mike, you like spilling beer tonight.
Spilling beer.
Powered up, dog. I love it.
Live stream saw all of
Hank
it.
Yeah. Spill.
But at this time, Hank was the king of country. Because even though Tony Bennett made the song huge, in the country world, it was also huge.
Yeah.
Everything's huger in Texas.
Yeah. Hank actually called up Tony Bennett a few times and pranked him, forgetting that he had pranked him with the same prank a few times, which was calling Tony Bennett and going, how dare you ruin my song? I'm just kidding. I fucking love it.
JK.
Yeah. I think he did that like two or three times, but forgot about it.
Yeah.
Every time and was drunk.
There's a lot of Jim Beam.
Just kept doing it. Yep.
What was his drink of choice?
Any alcohol.
Castor oil.
Alcohol. Okay. And I'm talking about liquor, though.
Why? Yeah,
because actually, when he tried to sober up, he was still drinking beer. Because that was...
Well, yeah.
Yeah, he would stay away from liquor. That was his problem.
Have you ever had, honest to goodness, tub shine?
I haven't.
Moonshine made in a tub.
Or bathtub gin?
I've had, honest to goodness, Texas White Lightning at Easter. It was great. It was good. It's a good Easter thing to bring out.
Make your eyes cross twice.
No, Yeah.
Yeah, if you had those eyes.
It's good.
Sometimes you wake up from drinking moonshine without the eyes that you
had. I used to have a stigma towards moonshine, but it's now it's just like, no, fuck the government.
Yeah, fuck it. Who gives a shit? So, Hank, at this point, he's the king of country. He's crushing it. He is the biggest name.
Yeah, hard.
But he rarely made it to a show on time.
Oh, and yeah, because of his nature.
He was fucking hammered.
Yeah dog.
Like us right now.
How old
at our
is
show.
He right now in the our timeline?
Right now he's like 25?
Six?
Yeah, 26, 26. Like a lot of his career happened the last like 4 years of it.
Okay, all right, cool.
So like 26. So the Opry tour manager, spoilers, when he would go out and chill and do his touring stuff, he would have to hire bodyguards, not to protect Hank from the fans, but to keep Hank dry.
That type of guarding a body. It's like a goalie, but for alcohol.
Yeah, he would take, like, you know, he would get paid cash, because that's what you do back then.
Hello.
So he would take, like, whatever money he got.
Get hard.
And he would always take, like, 100 or 20 off, which was a lot of money back then.
Yeah.
And talk to the hotel people and say, hey, look, this is the deal. There's this guy standing outside of my door. Who's got who's keeping me away from the alcohol? But here, get me some alcohol.
Yeah,
like, hotel people do whatever the fuck you ask them to do if you tip.
Of course, man. They used to go outside of the hotels and like his go to method was just like throwing a basket outside of.
I was gonna say
hotel.
Like that's how you do
it. Basket boy,
yeah. Little basket reel up. You know, here I'll throw a basket on.
Yeah,
give me a little papa.
Smart.
The most intense version of this was no one in the hotel was complying with him because I think that the Opry people paid them off to not do this. So what he did was he ordered tomato juice and then he ordered some rubbing alcohol.
Oh,
a Bloody Mary.
Yeah, he ordered it so because he had like, I don't know, he just wanted to rub it on his body. That's what he said.
Yeah.
He made a Bloody Mary with rubbing alcohol. Of course, that night he did not make the show as he was rushed to the hospital.
Yeah. isopropyl
as you would.
Is 200 proof.
It's not for drinking, that's for sure.
Isopropyl is for getting your erection.
That's not 200 proof. It's like 180 something.
No, well, you can't be more than 100, Doc.
No, you can be 200.
Yeah, you could be 200.
It's max is 2.
Yeah.
I'm going to say it's like $1.60.
So Audrey did travel with him because she was like kind of part of the band sometimes. She
manager.
Did backup vocals.
Oh.
No, she didn't do the manager thing. Lily was still the manager, and also sometimes his bodyguard. That's kind of the refrigerator of a woman we're talking about.
Was Lily buff?
Oh, dude, this is fucking
buff.
Buff
chick, dog.
Hell yeah, look at that shit.
She was doing the Tybo.
Yeah, but everyone hated her voice. She kind of sounded like
cats being murdered.
Yeah, like cats shitting out razors.
Nice. Oh, like, fuck.
Yeah, like, no one liked her voice. She was just there because of Hank. And Hank was like so big that the Opry even paled in comparison. Everyone else on the bill, like no one would give them the time of day.
Right.
Now, these used to be the biggest stars, but everyone was just going to the Opry shows to see Hank.
He's got
one of
the
openers. His name was Bill Lister. He was recorded saying a naked lady could have rode in on an African elephant behind him and no one would have noticed.
That kind of star power.
And he got pissed off because he was getting paid to do these shows and he's doing this music and no one gives a shit about him.
I was going to say, I probably noticed the naked African lady.
I would have too.
Yeah.
Sexual.
Very well, sexual. It was the elephant was African, not
Wait,
the lady.
The lady wasn't African?
No, she could have been.
Yeah, well, I hope
she's just a naked lady. He didn't really
get
equal,
a naked lady.
Equal opportunity
and
naked
that
lady.
Was the start of when Hank Williams joined the Bare Naked Ladies.
It's been
1 week since you talked to me.
Shot my head in half and now chilling.
They talk about Sailor Moon at some time in that.
Is it Chicken in China, the Chinese chicken?
Yeah,
that's
that
the one,
favorite
man.
Favorite part, yeah.
Yeah.
I love that.
Let's I like how you have a favorite part of that song.
Chicken in Chinese chicken, China, chilling.
So let's talk about Hank's style for a bit. Hank was the original rhinestone cowboy. Now we all know his friends, yeah.
Like a rhinestone cowboy.
We all did it together. We'll probably cut that out.
I didn't do it together. No. Yeah.
I didn't do it together.
Yeah. I did it.
I didn't do it.
In my ears.
Fuck you guys.
So out in Las Vegas, he ran into a gentleman by the name of Nudie Kotlarenko.
Kotlarenko?
No, I'm saying it all wrong.
Nudie?
All right, so the guy was Ukrainian.
Okay.
Ah, Ukraine. Hey.
So he's probably Nudie. Who knows?
Nutty, you, hey, are you the man that sings the country blues?
Country blues, so much.
Oh, so much.
So, this dude had a shop that did all high-end clothing, and the white trash that Hank Williams was, he kind of walked in and was just like, put some diamonds on it.
Here and there.
Put some musical notes. If you look at, like, performing videos, his suits are so extravagant.
At Trouble
and
they all cost here.
So much money. And it inspired him to open up his own shop eventually.
Oh, the Hank Shop.
The Hank Shop. No, they opened it next to the Grand Opry, the location where they were in Nashville. They opened up their own store where they brought in some of the nutty stuff. And people, like, they opened this shop. And people went fucking crazy. It's just this whole thing where he really was kind of this, like, tasteless fashionista.
Wow, they're getting hard. They're like, hey, it's got musical notes on it. We can go to the casino with it.
The casino. If you listen to our Liberace episode, you know how extravagant that he was.
Right.
Now, Hank Williams was almost like a predecessor to that.
But he's a redneck version of it.
He's the redneck version of it and thought it was stunning, the look. Now, like, Liberace, Liberace knew fair and well how over the top it was.
Right.
He was having fun with
but
it.
But he also had some class.
He was doing it for the TV. Exactly.
See, like, Hank Williams, they put, like, a guitar across a white suit. And,
this is
and,
fine.
A whole bunch of musical notes and gems and stuff, and he would go, this is the most beautiful suit I've ever.
Well, I feel like it's a little bit before his time, but I feel like if he was around today, be all camo.
Yeah. Oh, hell yeah.
Be all camo.
Well, Hank 3 is like
bedazzled
that.
Camo.
Oh, Hank 3 wears only camo.
Oh, okay.
Well, not only camo, but he wears a lot of camo.
Yeah.
Who's pretty awesome. And that's, by the way, I'm not going to go into it, but Hank had a son, who I mentioned before, Randall.
Hank 2.
That's Hank 2, and he became also a country artist. Not really my cup of tea. And then he had a son named Hank 3. And Hank 3 makes some pretty killer, like, psychobilly, metal-inspired folk music.
I also like how it's not Hank the 3rd, it's just Hank 3.
Yeah, me too.
And Hank 2.
Tasteful. Well, the Opry actually toured Europe one time, because I guess all those, like, Scandinavian countries and Germany and stuff, they kind of have a thing for country.
Dude, Germany and Northern England are all about fucking country.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Uh-huh. Well, this happened, this was the case back then, so the whole Opry tour went over there. And Hank, he hates every country that's not America.
Right.
Oh, fuck.
He's that guy. Like, he's very cartoonish in that respect. Like, he hated being in Germany because they didn't have ketchup. And he put ketchup on everything.
Even steak?
Oh, yeah.
Fuck.
No, no, like, everything.
Well, you need ketchup. That's Heinz, dog.
Yep.
Heinz, Duke.
Frank. I keep saying Frank because I'm fucked.
Yeah, dog.
But Hank always had a gun on him, by the way.
Oh, okay.
Even though he had, like, bodyguards and stuff, he had to have his own thing. He had two favorites. It was a Colt 38 and a Colt 45.
Two Colts.
One of them was ivory handled, and that was his favorite. I forgot which one that was.
It's always the ivory handled.
Yeah, ivory handled.
But that was always, like, just tucked in his belt strap.
You know what that's called? A Mexican holster.
Yeah. He didn't have and stoop.
Yeah, he didn't actually have a holster for it.
Yeah.
So Mexican if it, like holster. If it randomly fired, it would shoot his dick off.
Yep. That's why you don't Mexican holster.
Yeah.
You probably just buy a holster.
That's he slightly also had racist, no, but
had,
whatever.
He had no problem like just whipping it out and threatening people.
His gun
his
or,
dick
his,
or his
yeah.
gun?
No, his gun. He would just like whip it out.
When you say his gun.
And when you say
like
whipping
if there's
it
someone
out,
he didn't like in a room, he would have no problem letting them know by putting his gun on the table.
Oh, he was quick to brandish.
Yeah, right. Exactly. He wouldn't aim it at them, but he would show brandish. Them that he was armed, and he'd be like, "I don't like it. I'm also a psychopath."
Hello,
also,
this is the American him, South.
Yeah, I imagine him instead of just like putting it on the table, like just like licking the barrel.
Yeah, salting the barrel
blah, 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 blah.
And licking
guess what?
It.
I'm gonna shoot you.
Maybe.
Might shoot you.
Maybe.
Might shoot you. When he was in Sweden, my sushi.
No, right. I'm pretty sure he was like, why don't I speak English?
Yeah.
He earnestly believed 100% that he was sober if he only drank beer.
Oh.
I kind of also believe that.
I feel like that four beers deep. Do you?
No, I feel like that a six pack deep.
Well, let's put it this way. He tried to sober up a bunch for health reasons.
Yeah,
with beer.
With light
and
American beer.
Just being like, okay, no more liquor. I'm just going to
give me the Miller Lite.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Give me the Coors.
I mean, and he was often in bad shape because of his back and stuff and also some drug problems. But
oh, he's
the alcohol,
doing the cocaine? Is it morphine?
Well, no.
He did a lot of uppers and downers.
You keep your liver on your backs, and he had a weak back, so he must have had weak livers.
Oh, yeah, dude. The guy would be sick as fuck, right. And if he saw alcohol, he would run to it. For example, when he was traveling with that guy, Bill Lister, they were driving around a Cadillac, and Hank was passed the fuck out, Bill pulls into a gas station, goes, hey, do you want a coffee or something? I'm going to go in here.
An Irish
And Hank's
coffee.
Just like, no, I don't feel good. I'm just going to stay here. And right. He's in the gas station. As he comes out, Hank's gone. So, of course, Bill looks around the corner, and there's a sign that says cocktails, and Bill just booked it there, and Hank had already downed a couple.
Yeah, he's
even though he's laying there like, I can't move.
Had a few sex on the beaches to pick him up.
Oh, yeah.
Serious problem.
Oh, dude, it's like, it's scary shit. I mean, if American you know someone who has like a real alcohol problem, it's sad, you know?
It is sad.
But not only alcohol, he had the uppers and downers.
Really?
But it got really bad when he met a gentleman named Horace Raffle Marshall.
It gets bad. Or
Toby.
Toby? Yeah.
Horace and Toby's. Shit goes downhill when you know.
Yeah.
I feel when you know more than one Horace and or Toby, shit goes south.
I don't have any friends named Toby or Horace, so.
Oh, it's no good. All right, so he meets this gentleman named Toby.
No good.
And guess what Toby was?
A carny?
A man?
You're both kind of right. He was a con doctor. He was someone who never graduated high school, had a history of violent crimes, spent time in jail, and when he came out, decided he wanted to be a doctor and got some really good forgeries.
As a good, bad doctor would.
He's trying to get his life together, you know?
Oh, absolutely.
G-de.
But this dude used to carry around a little black suitcase everywhere he went, and it was just drugs.
Just drugs.
And he would just pump Hank filled with shit.
Nice.
Whatever. And Hank eventually paid him $300 a week, which at the time, like I said, that's about $3,000 a week to just be by his side and just be injecting him with shit. Got scary. And giving him pills and
So he had one of those like fucking Hunter S. Thompson suitcases.
Kind of. And he definitely threw some shit in there that could have killed him easily. So we'll talk about the second divorce attempt with Audrey.
Okay.
Now their relationship was like fucking insane. At this point, I think he had like shot at her a few times. Like, So this really destroyed Hank with the whole divorce. But also Hank cheating and just being the kind of guy he was, it didn't stop him from having a little hush-hush baby with a woman named Bobby Webjet. A name that...
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Tom, you made all these names up.
No.
Bobby Webjet?
Web space jet, which to me...
No hyphen.
The first time I read it, kind of sounded like a euphemism for a cum shot.
It does.
Yeah, it does. Yeah. It does.
It does.
Webjet. I'm a Spider-Man all over your face.
Oh, yeah. I'm webshotting.
Webjet, yeah.
Yeah, so he was with Webjet for a bit, and then
hold on. Back up a little bit. Go back to that thing.
Sure.
You know when Spider-Man is kissing Mary Jane upside down?
Yeah.
The original Spider-Man.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the original Spider-Man.
Yeah, it is. That's the first Spider-Man movie ever made.
No, there was a lot of comics and cartoons.
First Spider-Man movie.
First Spider-Man movie.
Yeah, okay, fuck.
Spider-Man OG. Spider-Man fucking Toby Moosh.
Spider-Man OG.
Yeah, Spider-Man OG.
Have you guys ever done that shit? Upside down kiss?
Yeah,
it kind of sucks.
No.
Yeah, it's kind of stupid.
I have not.
But I'm saying, so the Webjet, so fucking, he was doing a handstand. He was splooging upside down.
That's the rainbow.
And there's a risk. There's a risk of hitting yourself in the face.
Yeah.
But he had the skills to not do that.
Some say the user lives outside Webjet. Of that.
Webjet. One thing's for sure, Webjet.
Webjet.
Like it.
He's with the Webjet for a little bit, and then he ends up leaving her, as he does, and he finds another woman named Anita Carter, who was part of a... Now, this is a pretty normal name. She was part
Anita,
of the...
Anita, though.
Anita.
Anita what?
Anita Carter.
Carter. Now, she was one of those, like, family... In one of those family bands called the Carters that used to travel with the Grand Opry.
The Carter Fives.
And they were, like... her sister, Anita's sister, was friends with Audrey.
Don Vito.
So they ran in similar circles. They couldn't get away from each other, these two.
Okay.
Anita Carter, at some point, called him out on it because they were going somewhere and June and Audrey were somewhere.
Mm.
And somehow this... I wasn't really too clear on how this worked out, but eventually he just broke up with Anita Carter right there. He said he loved her, but he had to go talk to Audrey.
It's a love pentagon.
They ended up... June thought it was a good idea to get them to talk because shit wasn't going well and they're both nut jobs. So June agreed to drive them both back to the house and she would hang out there while they talked just to have someone else there just in chick. You know, we're shooting at each other here, you know, we want someone else.
Right.
And of course, as soon as they get to the house, he goes fucking ballistic and try shooting both of them.
And oh, ballistic. Ballistic in a literal sense.
Yes.
Yeah, very ballistic.
Audrey thought June was dead because she laid there motionless for like a few minutes, but she was unhurt. She was just fucking like scared shitless, which is totally right. Fair.
Yeah.
Hank dropped the gun and just cried and ran away.
Right.
We didn't see him for a while.
I also love this, like, tried to shoot them. You know what I mean? He's using Colts. Like, you just have to point it at them and the trigger.
He's also fucking hammered.
I know, but that's my point, is like, I tried to shoot them.
I'm fucked.
Alright, so I'll talk about one last lady, which was Billie Jean Jones.
Billie Jean Jones
is not my Jones.
Yeah, who was a 19-year-old who was enamored by Hank and his celebrity status. Therefore, he just got away with cheating, like... He was with her, and they actually ended up marrying, but he would just cheat right in front of her.
Oh, yeah.
And just be like, oh, this is what it do.
This is how the modern kids do it.
It's funny how they started dating, though.
Sexual.
Now, they were out with some friends. At the time, Hank was with another woman, and Billie Jean was out with some other country star. Billie was just a hot babe.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
And Hank couldn't stop looking at her all night.
Yeah.
They go to this bar. And Billie is not a bar person, so she decides to stay in the car. And Hank is like, I will stay in the car, too. Even though he's trying to get a drink, but he's probably hammered already.
Yeah. What?
He's been drinking.
So two people decide to go to a bar without leaving their car.
Well, no, because they were traveling with two other people. So Hank's date and her date went inside, and they start talking, and he gets really hot and heavy. And then Hank goes inside, gets the other two, and they say, we're going back to my house. So they start partying at his house, and the other gentleman who was with Billie Jean at the time went outside to go take a pee. Hank follows him, straight up gun in his face, said, I like your woman.
Ooh. Oh.
And dude was just like, I'm not going to die over this. Like,
yeah,
ever, man.
Yeah.
Wow.
Wow, Billie Jean is
so he held up a woman.
Pretty much.
He held up a woman.
Now, I definitely misquoted there, but... Like, paraphrasing. It was
painting
pretty much
a picture.
Yeah.
That's,
you're painting the picture.
Yeah. All right, so Hank's a mess. He's insane, and I don't know how he didn't end up in jail more often than he did. Most of the time, he got just put in the drunk tank, even if he did something crazy, like crash a car or whatever.
Yeah.
So we're going to just talk about how he died.
Yeah, dog.
Wrapping it up.
How he died.
Any guesses?
Cause of death?
I mean, it's pretty predictable.
Drunk.
Pretty much.
Idiot. Cirrhosis of the liver.
What happened was, December 29th, 1952, at 29 years old, in the back of his Cadillac, on the way to a show in West Virginia, an overdose of chlorohydrate.
Oh. What? What is that?
Chlorohydrate?
Yeah. It's something that's injected that our friend Toby was putting in his system.
Toby!
Yeah, Toby fucking
so what up. Is that? Just a downer?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's like a heroin, I mean, it's like an opiate kind of thing. And it was his back was just fucking killing him.
Yeah.
He only found out about his back problem when he was like 26 or something. And he did actually have an operation, but it didn't do anything because you really need to catch that early if you're going to fix it.
Well, also back in the day, they're like, hey, you got a migraine. Let me just cut a piece of your brain out of your head.
And give you cocaine and give you prescription. Cocaine.
Hank kind of knew he was dying already. A lot of the people had a feeling he was just on his way out because he was such a fucking mess.
Yeah.
And he actually had the driver of the car stop at a Baptist church so he could pray.
And then the
dude didn't know he was dying. He just took him to a church.
Right.
And then got back on the road. A little while down the road, he notices he's not moving. And
he died in the cab.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah,
fierce.
Yeah, pretty tough shit.
That's pretty tough.
After being...
Where was he going in the cab? Well, it was his Cadillac.
It wasn't a cab. It was a Cadillac.
Okay, so where was he going?
No, he was going to a show in West Virginia. He was going to play.
But he knew he was going to die, so he went to a church. Why didn't he just tell him to go to the hospital?
Because
I think he just wanted to die.
It was late.
Oh, I'm just thinking, like,
he's a miserable guy.
That's true. Yeah,
so he was probably, like, on a country road. He was trying to take him home. A
lot of foliage.
To the place where I belong. Like, West Virginia.
Oh.
Country highway.
Really?
You know, Germans love that song.
I know, they love it.
Yeah,
so do British.
Oh, dude, that song is ridiculous. Yeah. Well, anyway, that's our coverage of Hank Williams. I had to skip over a lot because we're running really long on this episode.
We fucking are.
Yeah.
Hard. Hard.
Yeah. Arby's?
Hard a la mode.
Arby's. Arby's. You can have our sausage or you can have our sausage.
Cool. So what do you guys make of this boy?
I think he's a drunk fucking idiot. And he's a hillbilly.
Live fast, die whenever.
He's a Billy. I mean, he's an icon. I'll give him that.
Yeah.
And I like Hank Williams stuff.
Hard.
But he's an asshole.
Yeah, his music is good. Like, his music is iconic. The music is fucking the dope. Like, and I don't think anyone ever described him as dope before.
No.
No.
But, yeah. Like, no, he was a drunk pretty dead idiot.
Dude, man.
Yeah, he was a drunk idiot.
Yep.
The way I like to describe him is he is the saddest I will ever be, just on a different path.
Yeah.
He's really sad. I've been that sad, but he just took a left at Albuquerque that I never did.
Yeah.
Very true. What about you, Mike?
I just think of, like, Squidbillies. Like, I think that's his whole life. Is just, like,
Kind
of. Like, super redneck shit, you know? Yeah.
I think he's a really interesting character. Like I said, piece of shit. Also very complicated.
Yeah.
A lot of shit going on. He was kind of tormented. Yeah, his mom really fucked him up.
Yeah, his mom is a little mean.
It's hard, man. You like him. You empathize a little bit more when life is pretty rough. Like
when he was crooning tears, it was all justified.
Yeah, it's all real.
Like, yeah.
It was like he was not posing one part of his sad, what was it, 27-year-old life?
Yeah. He just needed better ingredients. That's all.
Oh, God damn
it. That's all he needed.
Fair enough. All right, so let's wrap it up.
Yeah.
Thank you for listening to the Roastmortem podcast coverage of Hank Williams.
Oh.
Hiram.
Yes, Hiram Williams.
Hiram Williams.
I.e. Hank Williams, the hillbilly Shakespeare.
Oh, yeah.
Hello, I'm Squidward Williams.
All right, cool. I'm Tom Saltman. Follow me on Twitter at Saunched. SAUNTCHT.
I'm Hello, I'm Squilliams. You can find me at Travis Legion with two E's.
I am Cody McCann. You can find me on the Twitter at Cody McCann. CODYMCCANN.
And I'm Mike Regan, and you can follow me on Twitter at Mike Regan with two N's.
Follow us collectively at RoastMortemCast on Twitter and Instagram. And also, thank you for tuning in. And, I'm fucking drunk, man. That was a rough
Me too. I mean, I feel like that's part of the episode. I'm
Let's
just
go
trying
pee
to
in your yard,
Shane,
Tom.
I'm trying to drink you Shane.
Do you guys
want to be Shane?
Thank you, Shane.
Trying in that Hank Williams mode, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
Dude, Hank Williams out. Engaged.
Scranky Shane.
I try so hard, my dear, to show that you're my every dream. Yet you're afraid each thing I do is just some evil scheme. A memory from your lonesome past keeps us so far apart. Why can't I free your doubtful mind and melt your cold, cold heart? Another love before my time made your heart sad.
Oh, hey, y'all, you made it to the end of the episode. What?
Hey.
Howdy do.
Yeah.
Howdy do D.
Wait, so are they actually supposed to listen this long?
Yeah.
Or like, I'm
no, they should.
I'm supposed to be walking home drunk right now.
You're not.
Thank you for being patient.
Thanks. Welcome back.
Oh, yeah. Where am I?
Yeah. Good thing.
Don't go anywhere yet.
Okay. So, what are we doing right now?
I don't know, Tom. Didn't you do the episode? Yes, you did do the episode.
I did. And I'd like to extend an invitation for you all to listen to the Keith Moon episode as a chaser to the Hank Williams episode that you just listened to. You get to hear all about crazy boys who drink a little too much while playing rock and roll or country music in that case.
Country and rock and roll are cousins.
When you listen
to both of these back to back, it's like you're watching one of those weird porns you didn't mean to click on.
Deeply incestuous cousins.
Yeah.
Yeah, like a thumbnail that you misconstrued as a woman is a man.
Oh, I was thinking more like, oh, is that actually his sister?
Stepsister.
It's gross anyway.
Yeah. So anyway, listen to Keith Moon's episode.
What number was that?
That was number 17. Thank you for reminding me.
Bango, bango.
And what else do we got right now?
We're doing the Glossatorium next.
Oh!
Shedding just a little bit of light on what the ninnies need light to be shed on.
Glossatorius! Dominus, that's the Glossatorius!
Fancy.
Know it.
Travis's pinky was out the entire time he was saying that.
Yeah, but pinky means...
Dinky.
His long, thin, tiny
Got
dinky.
Our usual two terms for you. Travis, you gonna help me with this first one?
Oh, I'm going first?
Yeah. People want to know what a spicy boy is. And that's a noun. And It's a hot and bothered, otherwise intense individual, may or may not ask to speak with your manager. Now, Travis, could you so kindly use that in a sentence for me?
All right, so I'm going to use it as like, excuse me, sir, I asked for extra ranch. There is not extra ranch on this sandwich. And then I would respond back, hold it, spicy boy.
Oh.
Hold it, spicy boy.
Them's fighting words.
Right. Too much attitude.
Too much
tude,
and you're getting spicy at.
What is this, the 90s?
Here's my lawyer's
card. Lisa Frank folder?
Yeah.
What's going on here?
Spicy boy.
Get back to bed, spicy boy. That's what you want to say. When you meet a real spicy boy, you want him to get out of your face and go back to bed. That's how it goes.
And our second and final term is painting a picture.
Yeah.
Now, this is an idiom, and we're going to have our one and only Tom help us out with this. Now, painting a picture is the act of eidetic portrayal via word of mouth, because it's a fucking podcast, and pixels are expensive. Tom, could you use painting a picture in a sentence for the people?
What happens with painting a picture is you need to describe what's happening like an old school radio show, but it usually sounds like a tangent as it first comes in.
Yeah.
So if Cody, let's say he was telling me about his time in the park and someone stepped on his kite that has yet to be airbound. And
airbound.
And then goes, and then, oh, that reminds me of this time where I was eating the worst sandwich ever. And all of a sudden, Cody, this is where you would cut me off.
What the fuck are you doing, Thomas?
No, hold on. I'm just painting a picture.
Okay.
See, I'm describing something that will right. have to do with that.
Yeah.
It's the cool your jets because this is important.
Oh, okay.
And I'm going to put you there.
And it's totally not a tangent.
Yes, it's not a tangent. Totally
gets
not.
Your attention. Sure. It hooks you.
It hooks you. It's important to the story.
You sure it's not a tangent, Tom?
Very important to the story.
Oh, we also call that pee-peeing sometimes.
Yeah.
Papping.
Yeah, you're pee-peeing.
That's right.
Very, very technical prowess over here with Tom. Mm-hmm. Painting a picture. Well, that's it. Our two terms. We have come full term.
We have come.
I am full term.
Full term.
Yes.
Full term coming. Hey, by the way, if you don't know exactly what to retweet or at Instagram or Twitter at us, just ask us a glossarium term. A glossatermium.
like Torum.
Yeah. Ask us a
Regis. Ask us a weird word that you don't understand. We'll shove it in our glossary index. And you'll get killed in the mix.
Yeah, we'll give you a...
It's a win-win-win.
Yeah, we'll give you a custom obituary.
Sexual obituary.
We'll get you rigid with an erection or rigor mortis. And you decide.
Yeah, and now you're going to hear when we didn't get a full erection and we fucked up, aka outtakes, where we're soft.
That's right. Oh, I'm so soft, I'm hard as soup.
Keep it all in.
We're rolling again. We're cool. Everything's safe.
No, the fart happens. You're not responsible. The fart happens.
Shit got weird.
No, you barricade the only exit and then you start chanting. Shit got weird.
Shit got weird.
When would you ever use that chant?
All time.
Oh my fuck.
Every day.
Yeah. Describe my life.
Are we redoing that?
How bad? No, we're not redoing it. We're fine.
You just gotta do the
But you
ending.
Just roll into your bit.
Alright, fine. We didn't fuck up that.
So
bit.
So Hank's outside in Montgomery. He's playing for literally peanuts. Oh, hold on. We gotta turn off the air.
Oh,
God,
don't
damn
cut
it.
Don't cut it. Just make it live.
Just
Travis, make old man sounds.
Yeah.
So people know where you are.
Oh, my father.
My father.
He's dead. My father John's
father
dead.
Father John.
The wake is gonna be tomorrow.
Oh.
He's had so much better ingredients. I loved him. I loved him like a child.
I loved him like my own father child. He was like my child, but before he was my father.
What? Cody, what are you doing over there?
Turn
that
box.
Fan off?
Alright, we bossed that roll. Let's do it again. Alright. To keep her satisfied, but she just wouldn't stay. So now that she is leaving, this is all.